Hello everyone, and welcome to Sine of Our Time. My name is Bruce, and I want to show you this simple but very useful theorem called the remainder theorem. Wait, don't leave me. I know you probably associate the word theorem with some long-winded, boring concept in mathematics that you will hardly understand or even care to understand, but I am here today to show you that it is really simple to understand and very easy to use.
Yes!
So far, we have covered two methods that can be used in order to find the remainder of a polynomial division. There is the traditional polynomial long division method, which takes a long time in order to get to that quotient and ultimately the remainder. And then there is synthetic division, which is a quicker and easier method in order to get the quotient and the remainder. But here's the thing. What if we were only interested in finding the remainder of a polynomial division and we didn't care about getting the quotient? Well, I have a third method that I want to show you, which is the quickest of all three methods if we are only interested in finding the remainder. And that is by using the remainder theorem. Let's just take a minute to review what actually happens during polynomial division. When we take a polynomial and divide it by a divisor, we get a quotient plus a remainder over that divisor. We can write this in another way by multiplying each of those terms by the divisor. And when we do that, we ultimately come to the conclusion that a polynomial is the product of the divisor and quotient plus a remainder. In other words, a polynomial is equal to the divisor multiplied by the quotient plus the remainder. Here's an interesting idea to consider. What if the divisor was equal to zero? That would basically leave us with a situation where we have zero multiplied by the quotient plus the remainder. But hang on, isn't zero multiplied by anything equal to zero? In this case, if we have zero multiplied by the quotient, regardless of what the quotient is, isn't that equal to zero? That basically leaves us with a situation of zero plus the remainder. But hang on, isn't zero plus anything equal to that anything? So in this case, zero plus the remainder just leaves us with the remainder. It is precisely this thinking that forms the basis of the remainder theorem, which states that when a polynomial f of x is divided by a divisor x minus a, the remainder is f of a. I know this might sound a little confusing at first, but let's think about it. F of a just means that we are replacing any x's with a's. And when we do this, we see that the divisor is a minus a, which is equal to zero. Now, zero multiplied by a quotient, regardless of what that quotient is, basically gives us zero. That leaves us with zero plus the remainder, and ultimately zero plus that remainder is just equal to the remainder. Let's consider this example, in which we are asked to determine the remainder when x cubed plus 9x squared plus 11x minus 3 is divided by x plus 7. We could start by creating a polynomial function from this expression, by letting f of x equal to that x cubed plus 9x squared plus 11x minus 3. The remainder theorem says that when we substitute the value of x that makes the divisor equal to zero, then we will get the remainder. In this example, the value of x that makes the divisor equal to zero is negative 7. So we need to work with f of negative 7, which means that wherever we see x's, we need to replace those with negative 7s. And when we do this, we note that the divisor is negative 7 plus 7, which ultimately leaves us with 0. But now we have a case of 0 multiplied by the quotient, and regardless of what the quotient is, 0 multiplied by that quotient still leaves us with 0. Ultimately, we are left with 0 plus the remainder, which of course is just that remainder. Now that's just a whole lot of theory to explain why the remainder theorem works. Here's what we actually need to do when we use the remainder theorem. We take the original polynomial function that we created, and wherever we see an x, we replace it with negative 7. Once we have done that, we simplify. And as we can see, the answer is 18, which according to the remainder theorem should be the remainder. But can we trust it? Well, let's check by using the tried and tested method of long division. Now you can go ahead and check this calculation for accuracy, but basically what it's telling us is that the remainder is 18. Huh. Well, let's check again, but this time using synthetic division. Again, you can check this calculation for accuracy, but it's telling us that the remainder is still 18. Well, I guess that means that the remainder theorem actually works, but it seems too good to be true. Now that we have covered the basics of the remainder theorem, be sure to check out the next video in this series, in which we consider how the remainder theorem works with divisors of the form ax plus or minus b. Before you check out the next video, make sure that you are first comfortable with the theory by trying this question and letting me know what your answer is in the comments below. And if you like this video, then please like the video. If you want to support me and my work on Patreon, then please click on the link in the description below. Well, that's all from me, and I want to say a very big thank you for watching.